Ciao everyone, this is Nate on the Stone. Welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be talking about the public erasure of history and why I am not a fan of this particular fad. This trend really began 3 years ago when Dylan Roof murdered 9 parishioners of the Mother Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina, and after pictures of him posing with the Confederate battle flag came up online. People began to make the argument that the Confederate battle flag, a flag that did belong to a country founded in large part for the preservation of slavery, had no place in modern American society. And many states agreed with that. Alabama, Mississippi, South Carolina, and Virginia all either removed the flag from state grounds or removed it from state insignia. And then the parameters changed. It began to be argued that monuments to specific Confederate leaders, like Jefferson Davis or Robert E. Lee, had no place in modern society either, because after all, these men had fought for the Confederacy, the same slaveholding nation that the battle flag was a part of, so if the battle flag had to go, why would these monuments be allowed to stay in the public square? And many cities, again, listened to the people, with, for example, Richmond and New Orleans removing their statues of Robert E. Lee. Even statues not dedicated to a specific person were deemed offensive. So, for example, in Baltimore, a statue dedicated to the women of the Confederacy was taken down, while in Durham, North Carolina, a statue dedicated to the common, average, everyday Confederate soldiers was actually pulled down by a mob. And then the parameters changed again. It began to be argued that statues and memorializations of the American founders themselves had to be removed, or at best, recontextualized, because many of them had either owned slaves or had been a little too tolerant of the practice. So at UVA, the university that Thomas Jefferson himself founded, students there argued that the Jefferson statue on campus had to be recontextualized with another plaque that would list all of Jefferson's contributions to white supremacy, slavery, and colonization. Up in Chicago, James E. Dukes, the bishop of the Liberation Christian Center, argued that the city should rename George Washington Park and remove the statue of Washington in the park because Washington was a slave owner. Never mind the fact that Washington actually freed his slaves in his will, he at one point had owned slaves, which was enough for him to be taken out of the public sphere. In the space of 3 years, we have gone from saying that maybe the Confederate battle flag isn't the best insignia to be flown over state grounds, to saying that whole swaths of American history, which we either don't like or don't agree with, have to go by the wayside. And now the same thing is happening in Austin, Texas. In April, the city of Austin did rename some streets that had originally been named for Confederate leaders, Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee, the usual. But at the end of July, the Austin, Texas Equity Office released a report in which they offered more suggestions. It was suggested, for example, that roads like Dixie Road and Confederate Avenue be renamed, because Dixie and Confederate just brought to mind the fact that the South had at one point been a slaveholding geographical area, and that there had been such a thing as the Confederacy, which was, again, based in large part on slavery. In perhaps its most audacious move, the Equity Office suggested that the entire city change its name, because, you guessed it, Stephen F. Austin, the father of Texas, and the man for whom the city is named after, was a slave owner and an apologist for slavery. Even something as innocuous as the Confederate Cemetery in Dallas, Texas, named the Confederate Cemetery because Confederate soldiers and their families were buried there, are on a suggested list of places to be renamed. Austin justified this potential plan last fall by saying that the Confederacy fought to preserve slavery, that these names only memorialize racism and not the actual Civil War, that it's not just to ask Black Americans in Austin to support these hateful symbols with their tax dollars, and that having these names and monuments there is antithetical to Austin's stated goals of being open and welcoming for all people. And just in case people got a little leery about this, that maybe this was a step too far, the Equity Office even threw in a quote from the American Historical Association.
History comprises both facts and interpretations of those facts. To remove a monument or to change the name of a school or street is not to erase history, but rather to alter or call attention to a previous interpretation of history. A monument is not history itself. A monument commemorates an aspect of history representing a moment in the past when a public or private decision defined who would be honored in a community's public spaces.
It's true that there are multiple interpretations of the same event. That's why one of my college history professors described history as a never-ending argument. But that justification doesn't hold water in this case, because we're not talking about adding to the monuments or adding more things to the memorializations, including different points of view of the same historical event. We're talking about completely erasing one point of view and replacing it with another point of view. This is made even more clear in the Southern Poverty Law Center's revised report on Confederate memorials, which expresses the desire that these memorials be completely eradicated because the interpretation of history they give, according to the SPLC, does not square with modern American society. This rush to change or erase history we don't like ignores three things. First, like I said, this isn't about adding a historical point of view to one that's already in the public square. This is about completely erasing one point of view and replacing it with another. When a monument to the women of the Confederacy, moms and wives who kept their homes going while their husbands and sons were off fighting war, is deemed offensive, and when the very word Confederate is deemed to be a trigger word, there's really no other way of describing it. And there is a big danger in that. The 20th century philosopher George Santayana said that those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Now, in the 18th century, history was viewed as philosophy acted out, meaning that actions, words, and thoughts from the past could be studied in the present generation. In that way, the ideas and actions that worked could be kept and re-implemented, and those that didn't work could be discarded. If there is no more cultural memory of the Civil War, will we even remember it? Chances are we won't. And if we don't remember the war itself, will we remember any of the lessons that we learned from the war? The value of the human person, the moral repugnancy of slavery, and the price of freedom? Chances are we might not remember those either. But, it might be argued, we can learn all those things from books and from the education system. Memorializations to people and places that fought and stood for evil things should not be celebrated today. But at a time when historical knowledge is actually dropping, we really can't just rely solely on books or on the education system to remind us of our past. More than that, we've forgotten that history is complex because people themselves are complex. Sure, there are some characters that you can point to and unequivocally say they're evil. People like Hitler, Stalin, Mao, Elizabeth Bathory, your ex. But most people are a combination of good and bad. Robert E. Lee, for instance, he did fight for the Confederacy, but after the war, he worked to rebuild a new South, a South where black and white could live in peace and in respect for each other. Stonewall Jackson, another former Confederate general, he did own slaves, but at the same time, he actively broke the law of his time by teaching his slaves how to read and write. Everyone is a product of their time. And every generation gets some things right and some things wrong. Question then becomes, do we allow memorializations of the past to remain because of the good that people have done? Or do we demand that they be removed because of the bad that people have done? Erasing history will also erase heroes and their virtues. Robert E. Lee did fight for the wrong side in the Civil War. Absolutely 100% correct. But he was also a competent general and a noble soldier. P.T.E. Beauregard, another Confederate general, fought for the South, but after the war actively worked to desegregate the school system of New Orleans, and this during the time of Jim Crow. Are we, as a society, and individually, are we tolerant and open-minded enough to acknowledge the virtues of people from the past while also able to acknowledge their faults? Can we be honest enough and say that people who did and who supported and fought for things which are bad also had good points and that they did good things in their lives too? Can't we be honest enough to say that people who fought and supported things that were wrong also supported and fought for things that were right? And do we actually have the courage to imitate these virtues, like Beauregard's courage in standing up to Jim Crow in New Orleans? Second, despite the tone taken by the SPLC's report and the Austin Equities Office report, most people are not too crazy on the idea of removing, renaming, or recontextualizing memorializations to the past. In a 2017 poll conducted by Louisiana State University, the poll found that 88% of white Americans in Louisiana did not want monuments to Confederate leaders, etc., removed. Maybe not that surprising, you might say. But what might be surprising is that the same poll found that 44% of black Americans living in Louisiana also did not want to see monuments and memorializations removed or changed. And that fact does not quite square with the narrative that was being woven by the SPLC and the Austin City Council. Third, why would that even be? We're told that these memorializations don't memorialize the Civil War, but only Jim Crow, racism, white supremacy. Why would a good chunk of the African American population be okay with these things? Well, maybe because they realize that they have bigger problems to worry about in their communities. For comprising only 13% of the total American population, the black community, for example, is awash in crime, with many black Americans being the victims of black criminals. Fatherlessness is rampant, and black mothers are more likely to abort their children than white mothers. With these problems, maybe statues erected 125 years ago and roads named Confederate Avenue are not the most important things to be worried about. But what do you all think? Are monuments and names cultural touchstones that help us stay connected to the past and which don't really harm anybody? Or are they racist relics that have to be removed from the public sphere so that minority Americans can actually feel like they belong in society today? As always, let me know what you all think down in the comments below. Well, that's all for now, gang, and if you like this video, whether you agree with me or disagree with me, don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell for notifications. I post new videos like this every Tuesday. Thanks again for watching, and I will see you all again here next week on Top of the Stone. Ciao.